Thank you, Jason, and good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully we'll keep this fairly interactive, and I hope you take home some really practical points that you could all apply in your practice today. So I'll be talking about things to focus on during the procedure, which we do day in and day out, and it's easy to tune out, so let's figure out what should be important. So first, why should we care about quality? Then, are there any valid quality metrics for colonoscopy? What are the fundamentals of a high-quality colonoscopy exam? And then I'll leave you with some information on technologies that we might be able to integrate in our practice that might improve procedural quality, what might work for us. So this is why you should care about quality. It helps us be effective, which helps us be better at detecting and preventing colon cancers and reducing missed colon cancers. We want to be safe, and we want to reduce complications. Quality is tied to reimbursement, as you all know, through the PQRS, Physician Quality Reporting System, and emphasis on high-value practice. And then it's tied to patient satisfaction. So you really want to be in that top right quadrant in that chart. What should be the criteria for quality indicators? Well, it should really be evidence-based. It should be something that's easily interpretable, and it should be something that's modifiable or actionable. And then it should be tied to a key clinical outcome. In this case, perhaps missed lesions, which we all care about very greatly. Having said that, our multiple societies have proposed a whole host of quality indicators that we should be adopting in practice. I'm going to focus on the top three, and these should truly be the ones that are essential to any high quality exam. So first, about completion rate. So the multi-society task force gives us targets for cecal intubation. It should be 90% in all cases and 95% in all screening cases. And this is something relatively easier to measure compared to some of the other metrics, and something that every individual endoscopist in the room should know for themselves and for their practice. Is this associated with the interval cancers? Yes. There are several studies. I've just highlighted one here. This was a large study from Canada where they identified cancers that were diagnosed 3 years after a complete clearing colonoscopy. And there were about 34,000 colon cancers, and 3% were interval cancers. And as you can see, particularly for proximal interval cancers, compared to individuals that had low completion rates, physicians with high completion rates, 90% to 95% and above, had a reduced risk of having one of their patients present with a proximal interval cancer. Next, I'm going to switch to adenoma detection rate. Now, adenoma detection rate is defined as a number of colonoscopies where at least one adenoma is found divided by the total number of colonoscopies performed in a given time period by a given endoscopist. And the idea is high ADRs translate to a high quality exam and lead to fewer missed cancers. The goals were originally 30% for men and women, and in 2015, this bar was raised. Now the metrics are 30% for men, 20% for women, for a blended rate of 25%. Is adenoma detection rate associated with interval cancer? This question was answered by two large studies that were very landmark. The first one was from Poland, a cohort of screening colonoscopies on 45,000 subjects by 186 endoscopists. 42 interval cancers were detected over the follow-up time period. And compared to physicians with ADRs above 20%, those with lower ADRs had a higher hazards ratio of having an interval cancer present in one of their patients. And this is shown in this graph here. So you see a clear separation of endoscopists with ADRs above 20% having a very low incidence of interval cancer compared to everybody with a lower ADR. Similar data were validated by another landmark study. This is from Kaiser Permanente in Northern California. And they looked at colonoscopies performed for any indication over a 12-year time period. And the endpoint was 10 years, another colonoscopy, colon cancer diagnosis, or termination of membership. 139 gastroenterologists were included. So again, you can see very large numbers, 316,000 colonoscopies, 716 interval cancers, and again, you see the same relationship. Lower ADRs are associated with higher interval cancers, so compared to physicians with ADRs of 32% or higher, physicians with lower ADRs had higher hazard ratio of an interval cancer, and there almost seems to be a dose-response relationship where lower ADR means higher risk of interval cancer. But here are some challenges with ADR that I want all of you to think about. First, it's really difficult to track and measure. So for some of us tasked with measuring this, this plagues us every single day. Second, ADRs are not a static number, and taking an average over a long period of time can be erroneous, as I'll show you. Then it can be misleading. So here's an example of two endoscopists that performed 10 colonoscopies. The first one finds one adenoma each in five colonoscopies for ADR of 50%. The second endoscopist finds five adenomas, maybe a couple of advanced adenomas, in just one colonoscopies and nothing in the next nine. So you can see their ADRs are very different, and the second endoscopist doesn't meet the benchmarks. However, we have no way of knowing whether this endoscopist actually got to that, those critical adenomas that that were essentially would have led to interval cancer. So ADRs can lead to a one-and-done phenomenon. And finally, the true threshold of what the ADR should be is currently unknown. We've looked at variability in ADRs in a very large practice with 76,000 screening colonoscopies in a community practice in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis-St. Paul. We found that the ADRs were anywhere between 10 and 39%. And here you can see the ADRs by each physician. Each of these colored squiggly lines is a physician. On the x-axis is calendar time, so over a six-year time period, and on the y-axis is ADR. And you can see each physician varies a lot over time, and there's fairly high variability between physicians and within a physician. In fact, when we look at this closely, this is looking at a physician, and each blue dot is their ADR centered around 50 colonoscopies that they did in that time period. So you can see the more granular the data are, the more variability you see in the ADR. So this physician's ADR is anywhere on a daily or a weekly basis between less than 20% to as high as 50%. You can see the green line shows a smooth average, and you can see that the gray line shows an average over a seven-year time period, and it can be fairly erroneous and doesn't really convey the complete picture. So what we really should be doing is thinking beyond ADRs, and again, this study highlighted what might be the problem with ADR. They looked at 3,300 screening colonoscopies and compared not just ADR, but things, metrics beyond ADRs between these two practices, and this is what they found. In the teaching practice versus a non-teaching practice, the ADRs were very similar. However, when they looked at multiple ADRs, mean total ADRs per procedure, advanced ADRs, or mean adenomas beyond the first, there was a fairly large difference between the teaching and the non-teaching facilities. So truly, ADR doesn't give us the complete picture. Next, I'm going to focus on withdrawal time. This is not only a quality metric by itself, but it also is tied with ADR, where increasing withdrawal time seems to increase ADRs. So withdrawal time should be at least 6 minutes in colonoscopies without biopsies or polypectomy. And it's not just spending more time, but it's actually what you do with that time, which is the withdrawal technique. That time should be spent doing these four things: adequate distension, washing and cleanup, looking behind folds, and then segmentally inspecting the mucosa and subjective timing upon withdrawal. Because as this study very elegantly showed, just mandating longer withdrawal time does not increase polyp detection rate. So here, this particular practice required all their physicians to be compliant with a 7-minute withdrawal time. And you can see over the time period of the study, 100% of the physicians were compliant with a 7-minute withdrawal time. However, over that same study period, there was no change in polyp detection rate, regardless of size of the polyp. So truly, technique is key, as was demonstrated by this study, where they showed that segmental withdrawal time plus inspection technique improved ADR. This is a 12 GI community-based practice, and they adopted an 8-minute withdrawal time, and this made sure that 2 minutes were spent in every colonic segment. They also reviewed inspection techniques from high-quality videos, and as the results were that ADRs improved from 23 to 34% for the practice, which is a pretty substantial improvement. So now ADRs, withdrawal times, and interval cancers are all tied in. We studied this again in a community-based practice in the Twin Cities. We looked at 76,000 colonoscopies over 6 years, and we linked the colonoscopy records to the Cancer State Registry for interval cancers over the next 5 years. The ADRs were 26%, withdrawal times were on the average 8 minutes. There were 56 interval cancers over the follow-up time period. And withdrawal time and ADR seem to be correlated. Here you can see withdrawal time on the x-axis and ADR on the y, and you can see that there almost seems to be, if you were to draw a line, a relationship with increasing withdrawal time and ADR. And then we also found that withdrawal time was associated with interval cancer, where, as you can see, withdrawal time lower than 6 minutes was associated with a very high risk of interval cancer, and 8 minutes seemed to be the sweet spot, but prolonging withdrawal longer than 8 minutes did not substantially lower the risk of interval cancers any further. So, having said that, what I've discussed so far is how do we improve our ADR, since it seems to be the one quality metric that we all seem to be focusing on, and it's definitely remains challenging. We can expose more colonic mucosa. You heard about improving bowel preparation. We can assume complete insertion of the colonoscope, which is completion rates. We can spend more time inspecting mucosa, which is withdrawal time and withdrawal technique. Next, I'm going to focus on how could we improve the field of view on the screen with things like better optics, better view, that could also help us improve our ADRs. So I'm going to discuss role of technology to improve ADR. So what about high-definition video endoscopes versus standard-definition video endoscopes? A very large meta-analysis of 5 studies with almost 4,400 subjects that found that incremental yield for adenoma detection with high-definition colonoscopes was about 3.5%. So a significant but modest increase in adenoma detection with high-definition equipment. There was no difference in detection of advanced adenomas. What about NBI? The idea is it would enhance colonic mucosa, allowing us to see these subtle lesions, which, as you can see, are very hard to see just on white light. But with NBI, they're a little easier to discern. And the studies on this were mixed, and a large meta-analysis, again, summarizing these data, 6 studies, 2,200 individuals, showed no difference in detection of adenomas with high definition plus NBI versus high definition white light alone. And the study also showed that there was no difference with high definition NBI versus high definition white light for detection of flat or advanced adenomas. What about cap-assisted colonoscopy versus standard colonoscopy? Again, a pretty large meta-analysis with 16 randomized controlled trials, nearly 9,000 patients. There was no difference in detection of adenomas with the use of a cap. However, it did reduce the cecal intubation time by about 40 seconds. So if getting to the cecum 40 seconds faster is important to you, then this technology might be of use. The other place that this is valuable is for polypectomies, but strictly for ADRs, it does not seem to have a benefit. Retrograde viewing devices, this is a device that goes through the biopsy channel of the colonoscope, and when you reach the cecum, this device is passed, and then it's retroflexed. It has a camera at the other end, and the idea is to see lesions that might be behind folds as you're withdrawing. There was a fairly large randomized control study done where they had 2 groups. One group underwent standard colonoscopy first, followed by third eye retroscope, and the other group underwent a third eye retroscope first, followed by standard colonoscopy, and you can see that there were additional adenomas found on the second exam, but it didn't make a difference which exam came first. So really, a second look increases ADR, as we already know, but the benefit of retrograde viewing device seemed to be marginal. Other promising technologies that we've seen over the years, there's a lot of enthusiasm for FUSE. This is full spectrum endoscopy, which has cameras on the side of the tip of the colonoscope. So the idea is you're not just looking straight on, but also on the sides of the colonic mucosa, like driving a car and looking out the windows in your peripheral field and being able to pick up more lesions. There was a multicenter RCT done looking at FUSE versus standard colonoscopy with 185 individuals that underwent same day back-to-back tandem colonoscopies. The results were interesting. There were more adenomas detected with fuse, as you can see, a fairly large difference. However, there was no difference in the ADR. So, and its impact on clinical outcomes still remains unknown and is currently being investigated. Another new technology, which there's a lot of enthusiasm for, is the GI endoscope. So there's been a case, so this is a balloon integrated at the end of a colonoscope, which is inflated, and upon withdrawal, flattens out the colonic folds. A lot of enthusiasm for it. A preliminary study shows high success at cecal intubation, high ADRs, and it's safe and feasible, and more studies are underway. A third eye panoramic, which is an external device that clips at the end of the colonoscope, has cameras on the sides, allowing you to look at the side colonic mucosa, and then this can be used for about 100 procedures, and then it's disposable. So a lot of enthusiasm for this technology, and also extra wide-angle colonoscopes, which compared to the traditional 140-degree standard, give you a much wider angle view, allowing you to see things on the sides that might be hiding in mucosa we don't traditionally see. So stay tuned. This is a very important area, and there's nothing conclusive yet, but studies are underway, so we'll hear a lot about it. Other interventions that you can do, which are fairly straightforward and simple, retroflexing in the cecum versus re-examining right side of the colon during withdrawal, changing the patient's position upon withdrawal, so starting on the left versus right lateral decubitus during withdrawal, or changing their position from left to supine to right during withdrawal seems to improve ADR. And then water immersion and water exchange methods seem to improve ADR and also make difficult colonoscopies easier. All these seem to have mixed results, and they really benefit individuals that are low performers for ADRs. So in summary, good technique is essential. Here are the elements of a good technique: careful inspection, looking behind folds, segmental and time withdrawal, and looking for these flat, difficult to find lesions. Technology can help, but it's not a substitute for good technique. There's valid quality metrics that should be measured and tracked. Completion rates, ADRs, and withdrawal times are the three that you should definitely be measuring. And then our landscape truly has changed, and our challenge is going from being able to detect lesions like this, which were fairly straightforward to find, to these very subtle lesions, and then resecting them completely. And here are the tools that will make us effective at removing these. Making a commitment to quality every single time we're doing a colonoscopy. Measuring and tracking our quality metrics. If you don't have a mechanism in place at your practice, using resources such as GI Quick is very, very valuable. Having excellent prep quality, as you heard. Performing careful segmental inspection, and then thinking beyond ADR. So this slide pretty much summarizes some of the tools that you can use to improve ADR, and depending on how much effort you want to put in and with increasing cost. And the common factor is, again, persistence. So with time, things seem to improve. And I'll leave you with this comment from a famous actor. Thankfully, persistence is a great substitute for talent. So at least that's something we can all take home. Thank you.